Good evening, everyone.
Hey, what's up?
I'm going to share a scripture real quick with you guys. This is a story out of Mark, and that's about when Jesus healed a demon-possessed man. And it says, when they got in the boat to leave, he who had been demon-possessed begged him that he might be with him, that he could go with him. And however, Jesus did not permit it. But he said to him, go home, tell your friends, and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on you. And that's what I'm going to do tonight. I'm going to share with you guys what the Lord has done for me and a little bit about who I used to be and who I am now in Christ. And then we're going on a missions trip this Friday, Chuck Springer, myself, and Dave Rose. And I'm going to share a little bit about that too. So, God is good, is he not? Amen, amen. God is so good, he's so good. So, I'm from San Diego County, California. I was born in Escondido. And I grew up in a small town called Ramona, which is by, somebody out there knows where it's at. That's, you know. It's funny, when I lived there, not too many people knew about it because it was... That was East County, San Diego, and that's where all the hicks lived, and, you know, the cows were up there, and it stunk, and you don't want to go up there. But now it's like, go try to buy a house there. It's crazy. It's so expensive. But that's where I grew up. I grew up in Ramona, and I had a pretty normal life. You know, as a kid, I actually had a really good life because I came from a home where I had two parents, and my mom was a believer. My dad was a little squirrely, but he was still He loved me, took care of me, and it was good. Looking back, it was really good. And so as I grew up in Ramona, typical things that Americans did at that time, had a motorcycle and used to ride in rodeos, and it was a good time because you could go out and ride your bike, you know, down the road. You don't have to worry about people taking your kids or doing things or whatever, you know, and that's not the case anymore. This country's changing because we're turning our back on the Lord, and evil is coming. You know, you guys agree with me? It's totally a bummer, but you know, you reap what you sow, and that's what's going on. But anyways, for me, it was great. I rejoice in it. I'm very thankful that that's the time that I had when I was growing up, and everything was pretty good in my life until I got into like junior high. And I remember in junior high, there was a couple of kids that were my friends, and they were smoking cigarettes, and they're like, "Hey, bro, you should come smoke this." And I'm like, "Oh, okay." You know, because my parents drank beer, and I thought, well, just a cigarette, whatever. And thus began, you know, like 10 or 15 years of misery for me. And after that, it just, I remember probably it was another year later, I had come home, got off the bus, and my neighbor, he, you know what, I'm sorry, one thing, I forgot to pray. Let me pray real quick. Dear Lord, thank you for just speaking to me. I love you, Lord, and I thank you for... everything you've done in my life, and I'm just excited, Lord, to share it because you've done great things in my heart, Lord, and you've just done tremendous things for me, and I know that you love me because I see what you've done, so please forgive me for getting ahead of myself, Lord, and I just pray that everything, Lord, that I speak tonight is for your glory, and that you would just guide my words in my mouth, Lord, and just direct my thoughts and everything that I say, Lord. I just pray that you were lifted up tonight, and you would just draw all manner of men to yourself through the truth of my testimony, Lord, what you've done for me in my life. And I just pray that if anyone is struggling here tonight with any of the things that I struggled with that you freed me from, that you would just speak to them that there's hope and that there's power in the blood of the Lamb to break all bondage, Lord. So we thank you that you are the Almighty God, that you are so wonderful and powerful, God, and just love you, Father, so much, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so sorry about that. So anyways, when I got into high school, my neighbor, I remember one day, I think I was actually in junior high, we got home from school, and he had this really long driveway, and we were walking up the driveway, and he goes, "Here, man, take a drink of this," and it was a flask, and you know what it was. And so I took a drink, and by the time I got to the top of the driveway, I was like, "What was that, dude?" You know, I couldn't even stand up straight. And I liked it. Liked how it made me feel, and then from that point on, I started to drink more, and unfortunately, I never had a problem getting any kind of alcohol, and then later drugs and things like that. And it just, man, the devil just had it in for me. He was opening doors, and he's like, yeah, you want to try this and that? And, you know, my life just got really sideways, you know? And I want to share out of the book of Hebrews in chapter 11, verse 25, it says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God. And this is talking about Moses. It says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. And the reason that I share that scripture is because the Bible does say that there is pleasure in sin, but it's very important to understand that it's for a season, and that season will pass, you know. And for me, when it passed, when the fun was gone, I found myself in bondage and like torment. And I tried many different ways to stop doing all the things that I was doing, and it was impossible. So if in any way tonight I glorify the sin that I had in my past, you know, please understand I'm not glorifying it, but I'm not naive. I do understand that it's fun for a while, but mark my words, it will destroy your life. And if you are messing around with anything that I share with you tonight, you're kidding yourself. It will kill you. And if you don't know the Lord, you're going to go to hell. And that's that, you know. Most of you know me, I'm just right up front. And there's a reason I'm that way, because it's important to me that people know the truth and they're set free, you know, because the devil's a liar, and I don't like him. So, right? He says to be of one accord, so praise God, there we are. And, you know, in John 8:34, Jesus answered them. He said, most assuredly, I say to you that whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. And in 2 Timothy 2:26, it says, and that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. So keep these things in mind. Like the Lord said, you're a slave of it. You're, you know, the devil has you captive. And, you know, as I got to the end of my high school years, everything was going pretty good, and then my parents ended up getting a divorce because of some things happened between them, and I think it was like 2 weeks after I graduated. So here was I in my little bubble, thinking everything was good. I was partying. I'm like, oh, dude, who says this is bad? This isn't bad. This is fun. Cruising along, and my parents got a divorce, and then my brother passed away a couple months later. He got hit by a car on his motorcycle. And then my girlfriend moved away like I was with her for 2 years. And you guys know when you're young, like that's, you're like, oh, it's everything. Yeah, whatever. I didn't know anything. So stupid, but whatever, you know? So, it's funny because she actually ended up moving to Denver, and I followed her. I went to Denver, and I lived in Colorado for 5 years. And when I lived out there, I actually started engaging in like doing ecstasy, cocaine. I actually started selling cocaine and crystal meth, acid, mushrooms, I mean, whatever. You know, I'm being honest with you guys. If I was at a party and someone's like, here, try this, I'm like, yeah, okay. And then eventually, I was out one night and I got in a car accident, and I ended up in the hospital. My blood alcohol was like, I don't know, it was out of control. They were like, dude, yeah, I don't know why you're alive, you should be dead. I lost a lot of my blood, and I slid sideways into a tree, and my head and the tree hit each other, and the glass was in between, and it like embedded itself in my head. 10 years later, I got a piece of glass out of my head, and they had to take me to the hospital and do surgery on me, and I was in a coma for a couple days, and it was just terrible, you know. And I woke up, and as soon as I could stand, I'm like, I'm out of here. This is crazy. And I went home, and I started drinking again. And like, it's madness. Can you imagine that? You guys believe that? Does that make any sense? But I did it, you know? And that was my life. And I lived like that for, you know, I could tell you story after story of stupid things like that I did, and I just didn't turn away. And then eventually, I was in a place one night, and it was not a good place. And I remember it clearly. It was a party. There was a lot of people there, and there was a lot of coke and stuff going around. And I just looked around the room, and it was really dark. And it was like I saw like spirits, and I just felt like a super evil presence, and the Lord was like, you need to be done with this. And I was like, yeah, you're right, because this feeling is crazy, you know, like I was afraid. And at that point in time, I directed my thoughts back to California, and I ended up coming back here, and still was sideways for a while, living these scriptures I just read. You know, I had been taken captive by the devil, and he had a hold of me, and I just couldn't get away from him. And I met my wife. She's not here right now, but I met my wife, and then she ended up getting pregnant. And at that time, I began to hear God, and God said, "You know what? If you're going to make choices to destroy your life, that's one thing. But now, there's a child and this young girl. Are you going to destroy their lives?" And I knew that was wrong because my mom had raised me in Awanas and stuff. And so at that point in time, I was like, "Man, what do I do?" I tried to quit, and you know, like I went through years of struggling, and I started coming to church. And then this is one of the scriptures that I heard. In Luke 4:18, it says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me," and this is Jesus preaching in the synagogue, "because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives." And I was like, that's me, because I'm captive. The enemy has me. Like, I can't get away from these things. "And recovery of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And, you know, God began to speak to my heart, and he was like, "This is not the plan I have for you. I have another plan for you." You know, John 10:10 says that the devil comes for three things: to steal, to kill, and to destroy, right? And that was my life that I lived for many years, 10, 15 years. And then finally, when I surrendered to God, I began to live the next half of that verse, which is Jesus said, "I have come that they may have life and life more abundant." And I'm gonna tell you something. When the creator of the universe, you go outside and you look up, it is just marvelous, right? A desert night. You can't, the stars and everything, the cool night, it's beautiful outside, and you could stare up there forever. That is amazing. That is, you just can't comprehend what God has put up there. Right? And the one that created that says to us, "I have come to give you, every single one of us in this room, an abundant life." And I was like, "Whoa, what does that mean? Because that's abundance. Do you want that in my life?" And that's what God said. "Yes, I do." And so God began to change me. You know, I said, well, just like the Philippian jailer asked when he was in prison. He was in a prison. He wasn't in prison. Nonetheless, he was there. And when the earthquake hit and he thought everybody left, he was panicking, and when he figured out that they were still there, he said, "What must I do to be saved?" And I too, like him, was in a prison, and I said, "You know what, Lord? What do I have to do here?" And I gave my heart to the Lord, and God began to change me. He began to do just miracles in my heart. This July will be 8 years that I haven't had any alcohol. I haven't done any drugs in, I don't know, probably 10 years or more. You know, it's different dates for different things. But, you know, for someone that was loaded for 18 years, and I'm clean now for 8 years because God is good and he is powerful, you know? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Thank God. Because it's just awesome. And you know what? If you're in this room tonight and you struggle with those things, the Lord can take it away, and he will take it away, because that scripture is for everybody in here. He wants to give you an abundant life. He wants to set you free, you know. And so it was awesome, because he just removed that desire from me in one day. I mean, like, I couldn't stop drinking. I finally was like, "Oh, okay, Lord," and it was gone. And I was like, "Whoa, this is like amazing." You'd have to go. I don't want you to go through it, but you'd have to, you know, that's the best I can do to explain it to you guys. It truly is just very powerful in my life. And so then I said, "Well, now what, Lord? You know, what am I supposed to do now that I'm a believer?" And, you know, I spent a lot of time hurting people, taking from people, poisoning people. And, you know, now what am I supposed to do? Because you don't know. When you come to the Lord after those things, you don't know what to do. That's all you do know. That's the life that you know. And in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation." And that was me, and I knew it. "Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation." So basically, the Lord said, now that you and I are on good terms, it's time for you to go out and tell other people about me and what I have done for you so that I can be on good terms with them. And I said, okay. And I started small. I see Kelly because she's been helping in children's ministry forever. And that's where I started. I went up there and I'm like, okay, the little kids, they don't know I'm an idiot, so I'll start with them, right? Hey, God's good. He'll give you a place wherever you need to be. He opens the door. And, you know, it was a blessing because with those children, I could just work with them and just quietly and be patient and learn. I could learn. You know, the way that I saw them was the way that the Lord saw me. You know, He was patient with me. And that was a number of years ago, like I said, probably 7 or 8 years ago. And I have continued to walk with the Lord and to serve the Lord. There's been difficult paths or, you know, sometimes the road gets rough, and everybody in this room knows it. And if it doesn't, man, thank the Lord, because that's awesome, you know, because it does. It gets tough. But God has continued to change me and open doors for me to serve Him. And, you know, I'm thankful that I can do good for Him and His kingdom instead of, I feel like Saul sometimes, you know. He's like, man, I was killing these people and persecuting them. And while I wasn't necessarily persecuting Christians, I had a hand in spiritual death of many people, whether be it through drugs or, you know, there's other things, just many things I did, you know, terrible things. So God began to open doors, and, you know, now, this Friday, Chuck and myself and Dave, we are going to go to Indonesia, and we have some friends over there. They used to come to our church, Michael and Fawn Stevens, and they sold everything they owned. You know, I always read that verse where the Lord is like, sell everything you own and follow me. And I always have to ask Gerald, are you sure he's not talking to me? And my wife's looking at me like, what? I'm like, okay, you know? But that's, and Gerald's like, he calls everybody to different things. And I'm like, okay. So if it's going to split your marriage, he's not calling you to that. I'm like, okay, good deal. And so, but Michael and Fawn, they did. They sold everything they have. And they moved to Indonesia, and they've been there for a little over a year now. And they're part of a group that's called Heli Missions. And they reach remote tribes in the mountains that are non-accessible except for by helicopter. And so, yeah, I'm like, man, God's so awesome that I get to go and serve Him in that manner. And so I have two videos to show you. And the first one is... It's a very good example of what we're going to be doing. This is New Tribes Mission, and it's a tribe that's already been reached, but they are in Indonesia, and it will give you guys an idea of what we're going to be going to do.
I am Moi, like my father and my grandfather before me. Even long ago, our ancestors lived on this land. Strong people, but we die quickly. The spirits eat us. They control everything. What we eat, what we hunt, where we build our houses. The spirits watch us. We hear them in the wind. They control the night. They send centipedes like arrows to bite and kill us. They demand that we kill. My cousin committed adultery. The spirits were angry so his wife's family killed him. Still, my family had to be compensated for his death. Her family tried to pay with show money. It was not enough. Could satisfy the debt. A death for a death. This is the way we Moi people live. We make our gardens, we hunt, we build our houses. The spirits watch us. One day, a new voice in the wind terrified me. I ran to see what it was, and I hid. Strangers? Men like me? Or spirits here to eat us? My people invited the strangers to live among us. Years passed, and they learned to speak our language. They learned about our ways. Still, I wondered, are they men or spirits? The strangers shared the Creator's talk. A few Moi people listened. I did not. I overheard them say, the Creator is more powerful than all the spirits? I thought, this is lying talk. When some of the Moi people heard the Creator's talk, their hearts became different. At our feasts, they weren't afraid to break the spirits' rules. They hunted whatever they wanted. They weren't even afraid of eating taboo food. I told them, you will soon die for this. Death is small, they told me. The Creator's talk is big. I thought, is this really lying talk? I didn't know. I wondered what the spirits would do. When the centipede bit me, I knew the spirits were angry. My family slashed me to get rid of the bad blood. But the sickness grew bigger and bigger. So they killed a pig, but still the spirits were not satisfied. I was dying. Then they came. The Moi who believed the Creator's talk came through the night with medicine. They came through the night to save me. Why weren't they afraid of the darkness? Why didn't they fear the spirits? Each day, for many months, I listened to the Creator's story. I saw my own sin. I was awestruck. The Creator's talk is powerful. Slowly, the truth began to dawn. People who do not know the Creator. People who have never heard that Jesus died for them. Who will tell them?
So, that's where we're going. And I think, when I watched that, our friend showed us that video, Fawn and Michael, like 2 years ago when Dave and I were up there. And they're all, yeah, this is what we're going to go do. And Dave's all, Indonesia. And I'm all, we're on this, you know what I mean? We've been praying about it, and the Lord's all, Indonesia. And so, what a blessing, you know. Those people over there, sometimes it's hard for us to understand their lives, the things they struggle with, if they even struggle at all, because sometimes it seems like, well, unless you have bills and whatever, you know, that stuff is burdensome. But, you know, clearly in the video, you know, this man is, he's talking about the spirits, and they believe that they're in control of everything and that they have to please them. And, you know, you saw him cutting him and trying to heal him. And, you know, that's all demonic. That's all from the devil. He's a liar. God loves those people as much as he loves us. And those people need to know. You know what I mean? They need to know that the truth, that God loves them. And that there's a they just need to know the truth. Praise God. Now, there's another short video that I'm going to show. And then Chuck Springer's going to come up. And he's going to share on the Jesus film. That's what we're taking over there. And, you know, I just wanted to encourage you guys, as you watch this next little video, what it is I think they've gone back a few years later, same people, in their actual testimonies, they're asking them questions, and just pay attention to what they say. It's phenomenal, the things they say, just the details about who the Lord is. You know, it's a great little video. It's really moving. So if you could play that one real quick.
Anyway. any time, any time, you know. Now, my other forget, now I'm in a yard, oh, what you want me to do is more. Now, you tell me, but I'm not yet. Not yet, you
are.
I can't be here, you are.
You want to come to us.
Now, you tell me, but I knew we had to go up. We now elevate you. I am here. I wish one car can take
woman.
You know, hi, who didn't be car ass taking it.
And then we do the Audi.
Now I'm in a man. Then we are in a middle of having a little bit of a minute. Many in the woman.
Woman, not to your man, Simon. Is it not to Isidama? Is it Ama not to you? I mean, people are told me, even who people are told me to tie me into me. Anyhow, same good over me. It same good. Me ese edo enaga bi ese eliha naga ba fi ma ese mi hea ese waha do mi hea ngi
elo pe pa endo pe pa ku bi bi se da se hina
o
kai naga bi
edo ga bi
edo ba wo ma me naga naga ba fi ko mi ga se hu mai ki bai spi
wo o
mi ni iso si na
edo ala mo au
o
edo ga ha mo yi
tau ber ga huni ku am ba minasin ne ya he mani sin geni
eto ao
eto ao
kito ani wa bo he kito ha kayo kayo da tu ashi
o he to ni shiru ga ha to he
eto de bi pheo pa ha ao ko ya se eto ga bi ya se sim na ga ma bi ai ani ki sime wo me na se na to yo bi me di ha ani wo wa wa na ga ma bi ai se wa ashi pa me ani ki sime pa me ni ge
Yeah, so for me, that's pretty amazing because you can see in their face the life. You know, by their descriptions, the lamb, the one without broken bones, the righteous one, they know who the Lord is, right? And look at the change. You know how long it's been since I've seen people that I deal with in public smile as much as those guys? I mean, those guys are just happy. So what a blessing it is, you know. And for me, like my testimony is that God is so powerful that he took me and all of the evil that I was doing in this world, and he now allows me to be a part of something like this for his glory. So that, I mean, what's more powerful than that? That's what God does, you know, and he'll do it for anybody, not just me. So Chuck's going to come up now and share, and thank you guys.
Praise the Lord. Was that a great presentation, Travis? And that's what God is doing. He's changing our lives. Even being a Christian now for over 40 years, he's still working on me. He has a lot of work to do, but praise God. He's, as the song that we sang earlier, that he's not going to relent. He's going to keep working on us because he loves us so much. And God has allowed me to be a part of the Jesus Film ministry now since around 1990. So I've been at this for about 26 years, and I've seen a lot. These videos that we watched remind me of so many places that the Lord has allowed me to go. In the Amazon River, in fact, Pastor Gerald and Dave Rose joined me in Ecuador and Peru, and we saw people like this. And after watching the Jesus Film, which is the Gospel of Luke, been translated. It's been translated now in over 1,300 languages. And so God is using this as a very powerful tool. In fact, I have been told that more people in remote places of the world have come to know Jesus through the Jesus Film than anything else, any other means, way of reaching people, because they can see who Jesus is. They can relate to him. They can see the whole story. And you know, the saying that a picture is worth 1,000 words, what is a movie worth? I mean, it's infinite how God can use this movie to really change people's lives. And after we show the Jesus Film, everything changes. You know, the village becomes a Christian village. These villages, the people live in mud huts or houses made of straw or whatever materials, trees, whatever they have available. and they don't have any running water. They get their water either from wells or from streams. You know, they have really none of the amenities that we have, and yet they're so hungry for God. We now, this will be the 55th team that God has allowed us to equip and train. Praise God. And it's really a privilege to be His ambassadors. And we're actually your representatives. When we go, we tell people that the people in Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel are praying for you and have also donated. And that's why I'm up here. I'm going to ask you to donate for Bibles and also proclaimers. This is a proclaimer, which is the audio Bible. And these have also been translated in almost every language of the world. And I'm just going to play this for a moment so you can kind of get an idea. I'm not going to turn the sound up that loud, but this will reach over 300 people.
Ishak memperanakan Yakub. Yakub memperanakan Yehuda dan Saul. Matius pasal 2. Sesudah Yesus dilahirkan di Bethlehem di tanah Yudea pada zaman Raja Herodes.
So you can see this is in their language. And when they hear it in their language, the word of God, you know, the word does not return void. And the word is what set the captives free. And, you know, the Lord has commissioned us to go into all the world and preach the gospel and to tell people about Jesus and to teach the word and to heal the sick. That's the ministry of Jesus, and to cast out demons. And God uses His word, as you saw in this film, to transform people. And so you're going to have an opportunity tonight to invest. We can purchase a Bible for $20 over there in their language, a study Bible that we can give to the pastors. Most of the people that they'll be ministering to are illiterate, but they understand everything the pastor teaches. And we want to be certain that these pastors have good quality Bibles. And what I've seen in the past is most of these places where we go, they don't have Bibles. The pastors don't even have Bibles, or not complete Bibles. And so when they get a complete Bible, they are then equipped to make disciples, because Jesus has commissioned us to go and make disciples. And He has promised that wherever we go, He'll go before us, and He'll prepare the hearts of the people. So we see a great harvest come in through the use of the Jesus film, through equipping and training these pastors to use it. We leave the equipment with them, and they are faithful to use it. I just received a report here a few weeks ago from the last team that we equipped and trained, and Jonathan went with me on that trip. We went to Nigeria and equipped to train a team that reaches Southeast, the people groups there, which basically are an unreached people group. And I just want you to see a video here just for a few moments, and I'll just explain it to you. But we had a great result there. We ministered probably to about 2,000 people and had 300 or 400 that made commitments to the Lord. And we gave away, I think, around 1,000 Bibles plus about 100 or so study Bibles. So anyway, if we could play that video. Here we are at the airport leaving, and then we arrived at the airport in Abuja, Nigeria, waiting for our team to come and pick us up. And they also had this on their presentation. Here we are with the team leaders. Now, it's also a Bible college, and they had we had a pastor's conference, so we had many pastors that came. And we gave each one of them study Bibles. And we also shared the vision that we have to reach the unreached people in remote villages. And this is one of the pastors, one of the head pastors. In fact, he's the head of the Bible College. And here we're showing him how the equipment is set up. Here we purchased, like I said, almost 1,000 Bibles. You can see that in the boxes. And they were so excited about getting Bibles. And you can see these are quality Bibles. They're leather-bound, or they're well-made. Vinyl cover, but they'll last a long time. You know, when we give to God's people, we want to give the very best. Now, we went to some very remote places. In fact, we even had to make our own road. These are the huts that the people live in. They're made of mud and straw roofs. And we just go right into the village, set up the equipment, and show the Jesus film. And everybody in the village comes. Like I say, they have no electricity. So they've never seen, most of them never seen a movie before. And to get it in their language, they're just so excited. And here this pastor received all these Bibles, and he was so excited that he could distribute them to some of the people in his church that could read. Here they're watching the Jesus film. You can see how big the screen is. It's about 10 feet. It's almost as big as the screen that you're looking at. And these are people that came forward at the end to make commitments to the Lord, and their lives were dramatically changed. In fact, after we show the Jesus film, the whole village is transformed. You can see people raising their hand. It becomes a Christian village, and so it changes everything. And, you know, Jesus made it clear that nations won't change until men's hearts change. And these people are hungry for God, and so they really are very open to receive all that the Lord has to give them. And that's why the Bible and these proclaimers are so important. This is a typical well. They dip their buckets down into this well. There's a typical bucket right there, and they pour it into pitchers, and they carry it on their head. They do not have running water. And so this is real typical of a team that we will equip and train, and they will use this equipment now until Jesus comes back. And so, like I said, last month they ministered to almost 2,000 people and had over 220 people make commitments to the Lord, and they gave away about 100 Bibles as well. So it's a powerful ministry, and we appreciate your prayers. These are the team members that we equip there, and we're going to be taking pictures on this next team that we're going to be equipping, so you'll have an opportunity to see what we did in Papua. Anyway, I just wanted to share a few scriptures with you. Our testimony is powerful. In fact, we overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And so I just want to give you a little bit of my background. In 1970, I came back, Vietnam War. At that time, it was not popular to be in the military. And so as soon as I came back and I could possibly, after I checked through and was able to get out of the service, I changed into civilian clothes because everyone rejected me. And I had a lot of anger about that. I couldn't even get a motel room in Washington when I had to go through the checkout process. These black people in a Baptist church found me sitting on the steps of their church, and they invited me to come in, and they shared God's love with me. And that really touched my heart. I didn't become a Christian until later, but I had a lot of anger because of the way I was treated. And a lot of the other Vietnam veterans have been treated very poorly as well. Anyway, I got into drugs when I came back. I never did take heroin, but I took a lot of other drugs. And basically, my life was a mess. God sent a pastor, an assistant pastor under Greg Laurie, Calvary Chapel, Riverside, which is now called Harvest, to our ski area. I was the assistant manager. This was Blue Ridge Ski Area, it's now called Mountain High. And I we had hired a lot of dopers, and I would go over and smoke dope with them and take other pills, LSD and such. But I really couldn't relate to these people, and I was kind of, you know, seeking the Lord on one hand, but also, you know, the enemy had a foothold in my life. And so one day I had to change a shiv on one of the towers, and my dad was putting a lot of pressure on me to get the shiv, which is the wheels where the cable goes over, changed quickly, and I ended up getting a hernia in the process. And I came down, and John Orlando, the assistant pastor of Calvary Chapel, was there, and I asked him to pray for me, and he did. And I told him, I said, if God heals me, I'll go to church with you. Well, the next morning, the hernia was gone. And so that Saturday night, praise the Lord, I went to Calvary Chapel when it was a tent. This was in 1973 on February 9th. And Chuck Smith preached, love song ministered, and music. And Chuck gave the altar call, and I was one of those hippies, you know, the long beard, long hair, and I went forward and gave my life to the Lord. And I realized then that I needed to get away from the drug people. And so I left the ski area. My dad offered it to me, and I said, no, I want to do something else with my life. And I was still going to school at UC Riverside, but I had a lot of time where I could work as well, and so I got a job at Campus Crusade for Christ. And there, Bill Bright shared his vision to make a movie of the Jesus film, or make the Jesus film, and it would be translated in every language of the world. And so when he spoke, God just spoke to my heart and said, someday you're going to be involved in doing this. And in 1981, my wife and I opened a Christian bookstore, and we got the Jesus film and started renting it out to people, and we had pastors that came in, and so a lot of pastors wanted the Jesus film. They wanted to use it. And anyway, we ended up going down to Mexico, and we started showing the Jesus film. And then in 1990, we equipped and trained our first team in Mexico City. And then from then on, it just grew. And now, praise the Lord, the Lord has allowed us to equip and train 54 teams. But God changed my life dramatically. And really, that's what it's all about. It's letting God change you, letting God direct you. He has a plan for your life. I'd like to read Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. And remember in this film they talked about the spirit. That's the evil spirit, the devil, and demons. And I, as everyone else, in some way, some fashion, have been affected by evil spirits, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved, and raised up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it's not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. And so God is making it very clear that he pursued us. He pursued me. I was seeking the Lord, but it was God who sent this pastor. It was God who orchestrated my life to get me involved with Campus Crusade for Christ. It's been God all the way along in my life, where he has allowed me to be involved with different ministries throughout the world. And I can just tell you that there's no greater life. You know, Travis was sharing the message about the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but Jesus came to give us life and give it more abundantly. The abundant life is in serving the Lord. For we are his workmanship, his poema, his, you know, we're his masterpiece. And he created us for a purpose. And when we're walking in the Spirit, fulfilling that purpose, there is no better life. There's no more exciting life than allowing the Lord to use you to bring people to Jesus. Anyway, I would encourage you to make that step of faith to help us fulfill the Great Commission, and that is to go and make disciples by giving them Bibles, giving them proclaimers, the audio Bible, and the Lord, I promise you, will reward you, not just in this life, but in the life to come, to see people that come to know Jesus, where their lives are changed, and they will come up to you on the day of judgment and say, thank you, because you gave me a Bible, or because you were willing to pray for me, I am here in heaven. And so we appreciate your prayers, and we thank you for praying for us in the past. And again, we just desire that you can be involved in this by not only praying for us, but financially supporting this ministry. And the ministry that we're going to be working with this time, Fawn and Mike Stevens, Hella Mission, have a vision to reach over 100 people groups, 100 tribes that are unreached in these remote places. The only way you can get to these villages is by helicopter. And so the need is really great, but I know that God will make a way. God will provide the needs. I've seen it time and time again. And so I thank you that you are going to be involved in this by praying and supporting this. And I'll be in the back and answer any questions. And again, if you want to donate, $20 will buy a study Bible. If you would like to write a check, you can write it to Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel and just put a notation, Indonesian Bibles or Bibles. And we're going to use this money to buy as many Bibles as we possibly can to equip these pastors so that they can effectively minister to these people. God is doing a powerful work there in Papua as well as many nations of the world. And so what you give will not return void. And you will see someday the reward of it when you see people in heaven. So thank you again. If you would like to be involved in a trip in the future, come and talk to me, because we've got several trips already lined up. God bless. Bye.
Is this on still? So thank you guys, and just want to pray for us real quick as the worship team comes back up. So Father, we just thank you tonight for everything that you're doing in the world, and Lord, we just thank you that in spite of any discouragement the enemy is trying to bring, Lord, you're still on the throne, that you will not be moved, you cannot be shaken. Lord, you were just, you know, Lord, thank you that you just told Moses to tell those people, I am, that's it. I am. You are. What do we need you to be, Lord? Thank you for being all that we need. And God, we love you. Thank you for this church, and just pray for Gerald. And while he's up in Idaho, God, please protect him. Bring him home safely. God, we love you and thank you. We can serve you in Jesus' name. Amen.